This is my November 2020 solar PV and Tesla Powerwall 2 performance here in the UK, along with our Tesla Model 3 and Kona electric costs and usage. So stay tuned. Hi, John here, and welcome. In this video, I will take you through our solar PV and Tesla Powerwall 2 performance for the month of November 2020, plus the usual stats and usage information for the Tesla Model 3, the Hyundai Kona Electric, and the myenergi eddi and Zappi. In the description down below is a list of all of our components for our system, so please have a look down there if you're not familiar with our setup and our system. So dive straight into it. So in November, we produced a total of 289 kilowatt hours from our two separate PV arrays. We had an average daily solar generation of 9.6 kilowatt hours for the month, which, as you can see, is actually identical to October's average. Although, putting that into perspective, October was our worst month since records began, dating back to 2011 for our solar installation. So perhaps not a great comparison. If we scroll down and have a look at both charts to look at what each one contributed, our 4 kilowatt array produced 181 kilowatt hours, and our newer 2.34 kilowatt array produced 108 kilowatt hours. As you can see, really close to October's totals. And you can see now how October 2020 compares to the previous November's in a minute when we look at the year-on-year chart. So let me know in the comments section down below how you got on with your generation. I'd love to hear what your totals were and what your system is. Plus, as I've said before, other people like to read the comments and see how everyone got on. So it's a really useful sort of community sharing. So thank you in advance to those of you who do that. Do comment and drop in your details. It is very much appreciated by everyone. So let's have a look at the percentage contribution of the Powerwall and solar to our overall house self-power. Bring up that chart. Our Powerwall is in cost-saving mode. We swapped that to from self-powered mode in the middle of August. We were with Octopus Energy and we're on the Agile tariff. Often the unit price of electricity during peak is around 25 to 30 pence per kilowatt. So in cost-saving mode, the battery provides the power to the house for the peak period from 4 p.m. to 7 p.m. and it can provide a 5 kilowatt constant load or continuous load. So during November 2020, we were 50% self-powered from the Powerwall and solar contributions. As you can see from the stack chart there, 18% of that came from solar generation and the remainder, 32%, came from the Powerwall. If we scroll down and have a look at the peak and off-peak, for self-power. The Powerwall did a really good job of supplying the home's power needs during the peak periods between 4 p.m. and 7 p.m. During the month, I actually extended the peak period time slot in the Tesla app right through to 8 p.m, so 4 p.m. to 8 p.m, as the electricity unit price can still be a little high at that time of night. So the percentages on this chart represent the performance of the Powerwall's ability to supply the house rather than us pulling from the grid. The months along the bottom are only populated with data when we're in cost-saving mode. So if they're blank, basically we weren't on cost-saving, we'd have been on self-power. The red column represents the four-hour peak period, that 4 p.m. to 8 p.m. So for 98% of that time, we were on battery power and no pull from the grid. Just 2% of our total energy was grid energy during that peak time. I don't actually have the exact figures as my electricity bill hasn't arrived yet. But I've extracted the data from the Octopus Watch app, which I use, and it shows 12 kilowatt hours of usage for a cost of £2.88 for that 2% peak grid pull over the course of the month, which I don't think is too bad. I suspect that would be less now as we've had our old smart meters removed and the new one installed, which has stopped the phantom draw issue that was adding erroneous power usage readings onto our meter when we were running purely on battery. So we'll probably find that 12 kilowatts will actually be less from next month, from this month, December. The green in the chart represents the remaining 20 hours of the day, and during that time we were on battery power for 10% of that time. So within the 20 hour off-peak period slot, there are times of the day when the electricity is much cheaper. And to cater for this, I have the Tesla Powerwall app set with an off-peak time slot of 12:30 at midnight, 12:30 at midnight, through to 7:30 in the morning each day. And in the winter, this cheaper block of time becomes an almost daily ritual where we pull from the grid to charge up the Powerwall. This is done automatically via the algorithm in the Tesla gateway. But we also run our glass kilns, we've got three of them, charge our EVs if they need it, run our dishwasher and any other appliances that we need to. And unless we are forecast sunshine for the following day, then we hold off and run them on excess solar. Let's move along and have a look at the PV year on year. Here's the month of November solar generation going back to November 2011. The totals for years 2011 to 2018 will be for the original 4 kilowatt system, and the 2019 and 2020 figures are for both arrays. If you recall, the original 4 kilowatt array produced 181 kilowatt hours for November 2020, making it in the middle of the pack in terms of performance over those past 10 years of data. And the new array managed 108 kilowatt hours, giving us the 289 kilowatt hour total that you've already seen. So this November's total was better than last November's total for a like-for-like system. So 289 versus 222 kilowatt hours for the month. Powerwall in and out chart. So the Powerwall had a 88% round trip efficiency for the month. And during that month, we managed to store, 324 kilowatt hours. And we were able to get out of that 284 kilowatt hours. The figures are spookily so close to last month's, I did actually have to double check them to make sure that I'd pulled the figures from the correct place. But yeah, they are correct. So very bizarre. It's so strange that it's bang on the money for one of those figures. Day by day chart. This chart gives you more detail on basically what's happened on a day by day basis. I don't go through this on a day-by-day basis, but feel free to pause the video if that's of interest to you. The legend that you're looking at is blue is house usage, yellow is solar generation, orange is export to the grid, and red is pulled from the grid. A quick visual at the graph shows you there's lots of blue and lots of red. So yeah, solar wasn't great for us overall. We only had 2 days where our solar production was above 20 kilowatt hours in a day. That was on the 2nd and the 4th. And I thought, oh, we're in for a good month this month, because it was early on. But no, that wasn't the case. I actually had to adjust the y-axis, the vertical axis, to show 5 kilowatt hour increments rather than the normal 10 that it previously shown, just to sort of show the data in a bit more granularity, because it was difficult to see otherwise. So there were 11 days where we generated less than 5 kilowatt hours in a day, which is over a third of the month in the number of days. However, if we were to compare it to last month, which should have been better in terms of the amount of solar generation, spoiler alert, it wasn't, November, as it turned out, wasn't that bad. And as you'll see when we in a bit, when we look at the grid usage as well, what impact that's had in terms of what we exported and what we pulled in. So we made about the same amount of solar as last month. So, you know, not too bad, really, for the time of year when daylight is still shortening and we're less than 3 weeks away, basically. We're heading towards the shortest day. Well, at least it goes the other way from then. Let's have a look at our overall totals chart. So overall totals tracks total for the four data sources that we've just looked at on the day by day. So house usage is the key one, I guess. So 949 kilowatt hours. Compare that against 1,090 kilowatt hours in October. So slightly less usage over the month by 141 kilowatt hours. We've already looked at the solar production and we're about to look in more detail at the grid import and export figures, so I shall skip on to those. This chart looks at our daily average grid and house usage. As you can see there, our average daily house usage was down in November to 31.6 kilowatt hours from 35.6 kilowatt hours in October. And on average, each day we pulled 22.8 kilowatt hours from the grid, again down from October's figure of 28.2 kilowatt hours. In terms of what we sent to the grid, we sent 26.3 kilowatt hours of excess solar generation back to the grid in November, which is less than October's, which again is a positive. As ever, it's sort of made up of small bits and bobs, dribs and drabs, which tot up over the course of the month. I'm not really too worried about it. It happens, stuff that we can't use. If we scroll down and we'll have a look at what we pulled from the grid. So this chart tracks what we pulled from the grid each month. And this month is a total, last month, November, it's a total of 685 kilowatt hours from the grid. Again, it's down from October's total, which is good to see. Let's move on, have a look at our eddi. So this table is for our eddi, and our eddi heats the hot water by diverting excess solar. Once the Tesla Powerwall is full, then the eddi takes over and fills up. November, also a repeat of October in terms of monthly totals, so another 17 kilowatt hours. This gives us a year-to-date total of 389 kilowatt hours and a from installation of 462 kilowatt hours. The 17 kilowatt hours amount is low again this month, which, you know, means we would have used grid energy and or natural gas to heat our hot water. So just be a heads up on that. In terms of cost savings, I've taken the £1 cost savings based on a 5p per kilowatt hour, which is probably a little low because the average agile price we're paying is around 7 to 8p per kilowatt overall. But I've just left it as is. Talk about the cars. The Tesla Model 3 has covered 319 miles during the month of November, bringing its total mileage to 7,992 miles. All the charging for the Model 3 was done at home on the Zappi. We added 156.98 kilowatt hours, of which just 11% was from solar, 27.9 kilowatt hours of green energy. The remainder from the grid would all have been at off-peak rates or during some negative pricing, because we had some negative pricing during November as well. And to work out the costs on that, because again, because I haven't got the bill through yet, I've used an average of 6p per kilowatt to calculate the costs, which is probably about right. But either or, it'd be a penny one way or the other. So the 319 miles covered in the Tesla during the month cost us £1, 0.02 pounds per mile. So pretty good. The Kona covered just 79 miles in the month, and now has a total mileage of 10,482 miles. The Kona hasn't been charged for the month, as we did very little mileage. And I'm sort of tending not to use it at the moment in case it bursts into flames. It's on the recall list. It's actually been booked in with Hyundai for the battery recall fault check on the 14th of December. So I'll update you on that once I know the outcome of that. And then hopefully I'll get my confidence back restored in it that it's okay to charge and it won't burst into flames. And obviously then start to use it more. So down below, please comment, please like, please share. As ever, all of those actions help this video get shown to more people, and which obviously in turn helps my channel grow. Thank you for watching, and I will see you on the next video. All right, take care. Bye.